Today we're going to look at the Agilent 33210A function generator. The purpose of a function generator is to create different shaped time varying signals. Let's begin by looking at the front panel of the function generator. The primary purpose of the function generator is to generate a variety of electrical signals. There are six different types of waves that this function generator can supply. In addition, each of these waves can be configured in a variety of ways. When it comes to generating the waves, I'll focus on the first three types we can produce: the sine wave, the square wave, and the ramp wave. The characteristics of the waveform are shown on the display above the buttons. I prefer to use the numeric display for adjusting the parameters, but if you prefer a pictorial representation, the graph button can be used to toggle between the graphical and numeric display. For a sine wave, the primary attributes that we can adjust are the frequency, which can be selected by pushing the button below frequency on the display. The amplitude can be adjusted by pushing the button below that on the display. And if we desire, we can add a DC offset, which can be adjusted by pushing the button below that on the display. The DC offset will simply shift the sine wave up or down on the vertical axis. The values for each of these parameters can be adjusted in a couple of ways. One is to use the numeric keypad. From here, we can directly enter the value we want. We can also adjust the values using the knob. The knob will adjust whichever character is highlighted on the display. The buttons below the knob allow us to adjust which character is highlighted so that we can choose which value we are modifying. These buttons allow for more advanced waveforms such as a modulated waveform, a frequency sweep, or a burst of a single waveform. The trigger button allows for manual triggering of the sweep or burst functions. We will not deal with those in this video. The store recall buttons and the utility buttons have to do with the setup of the function generator and are not required for basic operation. The help button is pretty self-explanatory. There are two B and C outputs on the function generator. One is labeled sync and one is labeled output. The sync outputs a square wave at the same frequency of whatever waveform is chosen. This allows us to synchronize another instrument with the function generator. The output is where the actual waveform is present. Note that in between those two outputs, there's a label that says 50 ohms. This is the equivalent resistance of the output. That can be important if we want to figure out what the actual output is going to be for varying loads. Finally, we have the power button, which turns the device on and off. For purposes of this demonstration, I've connected the output of the function generator to channel 1 of the oscilloscope and the sync output of the function generator to channel 2 of the oscilloscope. This will allow us to have a picture of the waveforms as I make changes to the function generator. If you want to understand the operation of the oscilloscope, there are other videos covering its operation. When we power the function generator on, it is initially set to output a sine wave of a frequency of 1 kHz and an amplitude of 100 millivolts peak to peak with a 0 volt DC offset. To get the wave to actually display on the oscilloscope, I simply need to push the output button on the function generator. To see the difference in displays on the function generator, we can switch from the numerical to the graphical display by pressing the graph button, at which point we see there is a 1 kHz, 100 millivolt peak-to-peak signal being generated. You may notice that the waveform shown on the oscilloscope has twice the amplitude of the waveform on the function generator. That is because of the 50 ohm equivalent resistance of the output of the function generator. To understand this, you may need to watch the video on equivalent circuits. I'll go back to the numeric display so that we can see some of the things that can be adjusted. We'll stay on the sine wave for now. If I use the knob, it adjusts the frequency at the digit that is highlighted. If I increase the frequency, the waves happen more quickly, and as I decrease the frequencies, the waves spread out. I can adjust how quickly I change the frequency with the adjustment knob by changing which digit is highlighted. I can use the arrow buttons below the knob to select the digit I want to adjust. And now I'm adjusting instead of by steps of 100 Hz, by steps of kilohertz. And we see the waves change much more quickly. I can also enter in a frequency directly on the keypad. For example, I could enter in 100 and then press the button below kilohertz. I'll have to adjust the oscilloscope so we can see the waves. We see on the oscilloscope that we have a 100 kilohertz sine wave. If I want to increase the amplitude of the output, I press the button below amplitude. Now I can enter in a value of, for example, 1 volt peak to peak. Then, after adjusting channel 1 of the oscilloscope, we see the waveform looks exactly the same, but if we look carefully, the numbers on the oscilloscope show the amplitude of the output has increased. Other options I had for the amplitude were millivolts peak to peak, millivolts RMS, or volts RMS. Just for fun, I'm going to enter in 1 volt RMS, and we'll see that this actually produces a sine wave with a much higher amplitude than we might have thought it would have. That is because for a sine wave, the RMS value is the peak voltage divided by the square root of 2. So when I enter in 1 volt RMS on the function generator, I get a peak voltage of about 1.4 volts, which is 2.8 volts peak to peak. But because the output resistance of the function generator is so low and there is no load resistor, the oscilloscope is displaying a peak to peak voltage of just over 5.6 volts. To see the effect of the offset voltage, I'll adjust the offset to minus 1 volt, and you can see the sine wave remains the same, but it is shifted down. You may have noticed that the sync or synchronization wave has stayed basically the same regardless of the changes I am making, with the exception of the frequency. That is because the purpose of the sync wave is to provide a frequency reference for other devices, so only the frequency changes affect the output of the sync wave. Now let's change the output of the function generator to a square wave. Since we have a square wave at the output, I'm going to turn the display of the synchronization wave down so we can clearly differentiate between the output of the function generator and the synchronization wave. With the square wave, we have the same options for adjusting the frequency and amplitude that we had with the sine wave, and we can also adjust the DC offset up or down if we desire. An additional adjustment we have is something called a duty cycle. A square wave has 2 voltage levels, a high voltage level and a low voltage level. The duty cycle of the square wave is the percentage of time that the wave is at the high voltage. So if I were to enter in a duty cycle of 20%, that means the signal would be at the high voltage 20% of the time and at its low value 80% of the time. We see that adjustment on the oscilloscope. I can adjust the duty cycle between 20 and 80%. A reason we might want to adjust the duty cycle of the square wave would be to adjust the effective output power of the waveform for applications such as pulse width modulation. Let's move on to the ramp wave. Here we see an output voltage that increases linearly up to a point and then starts over. Many of the same adjustments are here. We can adjust the frequency of the wave, the amplitude of the wave, or the DC offset of the wave. Another option we have is the symmetry of the wave. On this function generator, 100% symmetry is a ramp wave. As I turn the symmetry down to 50%, we get a triangle wave. And if I turn the symmetry down to 0%, we get a backward ramp wave. To return to the original ramp wave, I can simply enter in 100 and hit the button below the percent on the display. That covers the basic functionality of the function generator. To review the basic outputs, we have a sine wave where we can adjust the frequency, the amplitude, or the DC offset. We can do the same of the square waves with the addition of having the adjustable duty cycle. For the ramp wave, we have the added capability of adjusting the symmetry to obtain a triangle wave. Hopefully that's enough to get you started with using the function generator. To reiterate, the purpose of the function generator is to create different waveforms so that we can see how our circuits respond to them. That's all for today. Go out and make it a great one.